bit about the basics. So hopefully all of you know that there are really four sources in which we derive financial aid from. So there's the federal government, there's the state, and then there are the schools and the institutions that your children will be applying to or are interested in attending. And the last source are private, outside scholarship organizations, individuals, other entities that award grants and scholarships to students. So when the student applies for financial aid, they will automatically be considered for all aid offered by the federal government, by the state, and by the schools that they are interested in or planning on attending. The private outside organizations is one in which we're going to need to research, and because of the technology that we have today, it does make it a lot easier for students to create a profile about themselves, send it out through the internet, and then they'll get matched up to any private outside scholarships that match the profile, gives them all the information about applying for that outside scholarship. In most cases, you're going to find that any outside scholarship money a student brings to a school may be in addition to what the school has already awarded, and the majority of that is grants and scholarships. So we really want to encourage students to do that, and we really want them to do that early on. So hopefully my seniors have already started doing this. If they haven't, I would highly suggest that they start doing that now because a lot of the deadline dates that they need to apply or submit the information usually are pretty early, January, February, March. For my juniors, sophomores, even freshmen, absolutely, this is something that you should be doing now. In addition to looking at your colleges, you know, seeing which schools offer your programs or what you're interested in, other resources that you may be looking for from your higher education institution, you should also be searching private outside scholarships. And it's nice to do it early on because you're going to get all the criteria. If you're missing anything, you have the next year, 2 years, maybe 3 years to get that done before you're actually going to apply. So the other issue that I want to talk about, basic information, is the types of financial aid. I usually put financial aid into three categories. So I think it's important that students understand the types of awards, the type of aid that is going to be awarded to them, so that they know what they're committing to. So the first area that I look at is merit-based money, usually awarded in the form of a scholarship. Has nothing to do with the family's financial circumstances, number in the household, number in college, age of the older parent. You don't look at any of that. It's usually the student bringing something special to that school. So it could be academic ability, they're going to get an academic scholarship, it could be athletic ability, it could be some other special talent, art, music. Maybe they're majoring in a particular major within that college that they're trying to grow. Maybe they're going into an honors college and the school is going to award them a scholarship for them. So again, it has nothing to do with your financial situation at all. It's based on what that student is bringing to the school and that they meet that criteria that that school has set up. Now, some schools still require the student to file for financial aid, even if they're awarded a merit-based scholarship, because they want to determine or make sure that the student is eligible for any other types of aid, that they can also award that to them as well. So you're just going to have to review the policies and procedures of the schools that the student's looking at to determine whether or not they require them to fill out any financial aid forms. I would encourage all of you to apply for financial aid because the rules and regulations change all the time, and your circumstances can change. And I've seen this in my years in doing financial aid at various colleges and universities that I've worked at. There are a lot of things that happen within a family. You know, some of them we have no idea, you know, what tomorrow may bring. You know, and if you wait then to apply for financial aid, it's probably going to be too late. If you apply, you have the information, you can probably work with you and help you deal with those circumstances that may be happening in your family. The other type of aid that we have out there that's also what I call gift aid or free money is grants and scholarships. But this is where a student would have to demonstrate need. So this is really why you're filling out those financial aid forms, because there are different formulas that we would put the student through to try to determine what is the student's need at this school. And then the school then will award other need-based grants and scholarships or other need-based aid that that school may be participating in. Again, free money. And the last source is what I call self-help. And your self-help money is all of your federal student loan programs. So all of your children are automatically eligible to participate in the federal student loan program. There's no collateral, there's no credit check, they can get it. Now they are limited to the amount that they can borrow each year, and there's an aggregate amount that they can borrow through the life of the program. We'll talk a little bit about that as we go, as we get through the presentation. There is also a loan out there offered by the federal government for parents. If you want to assist that student meeting educational expenses, there is a loan there that you can participate in from the federal government as well. And then there is also the federal work-study program. The state also offers a work-study program. And basically, it's a very flexible program. The student actually has to work a job when they're off campus. They will receive a paycheck, usually every 2 weeks, for the number of hours that they work. And it's as I said, it's very flexible. There's a lot of options available from that program, but they actually have to work a job in order to receive those funds. So I usually tell students, because it's one of the questions that is presented to you on the financial aid form, it says to the student, are you a student work study? I tell students to say yes. And the reason I encourage them to do that is because those funding levels usually are pretty low at schools, and that money is given out pretty quickly. So if you are interested, and you think you may be interested, indicate yes. Most of the time, the school's going to follow up with you to determine whether or not you're really going to use that money or not. So it's very flexible. You may say, I want to do it my first semester. I want to save the money to next semester. I want to get my stuff acclimated to the school, academics, and all of that for the first semester. And that's fine. If you wait until you get to school and say, I have time, I can fit in my schedule, there's a job that I would like to do that's related to my major, something else I'm interested in, it's probably going to be too late. The funding probably won't be there. So just say yes, you can always turn it down if it's something that you're not interested in. Okay, so now let's get into looking at what we need to do. So in order to receive financial aid, you actually have to apply. Everybody needs to fill out the pre-application for federal student aid. And I'm going to emphasize the word free. It's a free form. Okay? So regardless of what type of school the student is looking at, and as you know, there are many options, many choices. Community colleges in the state of Pennsylvania have 14 state schools. We have 5 state-related schools, Penn State University, Pittsburgh, Temple, Lincoln University, and Pennsylvania Institute of Technology, state-related schools. We have visit-trade technical schools, hospital schools, and there's all kinds of private schools out there. They all participate in financial aid. So you will need to complete the FAFSA, for regardless of what type of school that you are considering. For state grant purposes, we actually do not have a separate application. We actually, for every Pennsylvania resident, we get a copy of that information from the FAFSA. The majority of the information that we need to determine the student's eligibility for state grant is the same as what you're putting on the FAFSA. Now, unfortunately, because of the way our program is legislated, there is some information that our legislators require us to confirm. And then there's other information that we can't get from the FAFSA. So for first-time applicants only, they will need to complete what we call the state grant form. It's about 6 additional questions. They will have the opportunity to do that at the same time that they complete the FAFSA. And I'm going to talk about that and show you how to go about doing that. So everyone has to fill out the FAFSA regardless of the school you're looking at. Now, the other form that you may have to fill out in addition to FAFSA is the school may have their own institutional form, or they may use the CSS profile. I'm going to tell you right now, if you're looking at a community college, a business trade or technical school, hospital school, nursing, state-related schools, state schools, none of them use the profile. It's usually private institutions. And there's about, 240 of them across the country. So in order to be considered for all aid by those schools, student needs to fill out the FAFSA, and they also need to fill out the CSS profile. Okay. So just a little bit of difference between the two forms so you understand it. The FAFSA is for federal aid. Congress each year approves the federal methodology of various formulas that the U.S. Department of Education uses to determine the student's eligibility for need-based aid. The CSS profile uses institutional methodology. So each institution that uses that form sets up their own formula. And they use that to award their institutional aid only. Okay, so the CSS profile, the information you provide on that form, has no impact on the federal formula or the state formula. Schools can only use that to award their institutional aid, and that's what the difference is. Now, you're going to find as we go through this that the FAFSA is very easy to complete. It won't take you very long at all, probably about 20 minutes, 30 max, I would think. CSS profile is more in depth, and it's going to ask for a lot of more detailed information, and it takes into consideration a lot more what's going on with the family. So you're probably going to need probably a good hour set aside, undisturbed, locked away in a room to complete that form. Okay? So just be prepared for it. Okay. So this is the official website that the student wants to go to complete the FAFSA. The reason I bring this up is, as I said, the FAFSA is a free form. However, there are places that you can go out and complete the FAFSA that they will charge you. So I'm going to encourage you, don't pay anyone to complete the FAFSA. There's lots of free help from the federal government, the state, the schools, the colleges. They'll all be willing to help you as well. So FAFSA.gov or FAFSA.edu.gov. Please keep in mind that your FAFSA application is good for 1 year. Okay, so you have to reapply each year. Now, for my seniors, you will need to complete the 2017-18 FAFSA. Okay, so make sure that you're completing the 17-18 FAFSA because that's the FAFSA that applies to the year that you're going to be starting college. There is the 16-17 FAFSA still out there and it's still active. Okay, I've had families say, oh, I didn't complete the form. I said, not for 17-18, it's not even available. And they go back and tell me, oh, you're right. I said, yeah, you won't get aid for 17-18 if you don't fill out the 17-18 FAFSA. So please keep that in mind as well. Also on this screen, I want to point out for my junior families that FAFSA Forecaster. That's a tool that the federal government provides that kind of simulates the FAFSA application. It's not an application, but it takes in a lot of the same information that you'll use on the FAFSA that you can put in there, and then it will then give you some results such as what your estimated family contribution would be. And that's an important number because that's the number that every school uses to determine the student's need at their school. It'll also tell you if your child will be eligible for the federal Pell Grant program, and it tells you what their eligibility for the federal direct student loan program is as well. So it's a nice tool that you can kind of use as an estimate to tweak your plan or put a plan together. Once you get off of that form or that site, all that information disappears. So it's not an application, you can't submit it anywhere. It's just a tool to kind of give you an idea of if your child is going to school next year, what would it look like? What would our financial situation look like? Okay, so the FAFSA is used to determine the student's eligibility for all federal aid. So there's the federal Pell Grant program out there. There is the federal work study programs. There is the federal direct student loan program and federal parent loan program. There's also a federal TEACH grant for students who are interested in becoming a teacher. There's actually another grant program out there that student may tap into as a resource. Now, not all schools participate in that program, and they have different policies and procedures of when they would award that to a student, but it's really for those students who think that they're going into the teaching. There are some other federal programs out there. I'm not going to go through those tonight because the criteria is very specific. So I'm going to give you a website for the federal government that you can see all of those. Also, you can, the PA student aid guide that you picked up here, it's also on the FIA website. It has all the federal programs as well as all the state programs, so you can look at that as a resource as well. As I said, we also use the information from the FAFSA to determine the student's eligibility for the Pennsylvania State Grant Program. That's our flagship program. But again, there are school may be awarded the time. Okay, so the FAFSA you can do complete two ways. Online application, or you can download a PDF of the online application. I'm going to encourage all of you to do the online application. It's easier, it's simple, it's processed a lot quicker. There's a lot of really nice benefit to build into that application that you're not going to get with the PDF version. With the PDF version, basically, if you don't want to do the online application, and you don't have to, you download that onto the computer, you can access the information on your computer, then you have to print out that application. The student needs to sign it, parent needs one, and you need to sign it. You need to send it to the federal government for process. Now, you're going to find that if you are doing that, changes, special circumstances within their family are saying, Can I use 2016 information? Can I estimate and use 2017 income information when my child actually is going to be entering school? The answer to that is no. You must use 2015 income tax information for the 17-18 FAFSA. Now, if there are special circumstances within your family, you know, maybe somebody lost a job, changed a job, reduction in income, whatever, because we're looking at income, it's 2 years old. You know, there are ways in which we can handle that, and I'm going to review that with you. The other change that I want you to be aware of, or truly not a change, is it has to do with asset information, okay? You may be required to provide asset information, and you may not. Well, it depends on how you answer some questions within the FAFSA. But if you are required to provide asset information, you have to put in the net value of your assets as of the day you're filing the FAFSA. Okay, so income information is 2 years old, 2015. Asset information is the date you're filling out that form. Okay, so if I had $1,000 in my bank account today, filling out the FAFSA tomorrow, and I took that $1,000 and I paid a bill. Tomorrow I have nothing in my bank account, and that's what I'm putting it, zero. Because it's the day that I'm filing the FAFSA, that account is empty. So, just letting you know, that's how that works. Okay. For the CSS profile, I just wanted to mention is that application is always available October 1st. However, the college board is also moving to the same process as the federal government, and you will need to use 2015 income tax information to complete the profile as well. Okay. Deadline dates, I always harp on this, extremely important. You want to be aware of this. Because everybody has different deadlines. You're going to find that the federal government has the latest of deadlines. So for the 2017-18 award year, that student has up until June 30th, 2018 to complete the FAFSA and still be considered for federal aid. Now for state grant purposes, for any returning student or any new student, or new applicant, that is going into a degree-granting institution, our deadline is May 1st. So you have to file a FAFSA on May 1st to be considered on time for the state. Unless a first-time applicant is looking at a community college, business trade or technical school, hospital school, nursing, two-year non-transferable program. In Pennsylvania, we have eight open admissions institutions that are designated by the U.S. Department of Education. So if they're looking, if a first-time applicant is looking to enter one of those types of schools, we give them until August 1st to complete the FAFSA and still be on time. Now for the schools, they make up their own deadline. And you're going to find that most schools have earlier deadline dates than the state as well as the federal government. So it's not a secret. You can ask the admissions office, the financial aid office, go out to their website, and they should clearly give you information in terms of what forms you need to complete to be considered for all aid offers by that school, and when do those forms need to be in so that you can be considered for all aid offers by those schools. Please don't miss a deadline, okay? Because if you do, I guarantee you, you will not be considered for all aid offers by that school. I'd like to go over this because the FAFSA to me is really the student's application. So please keep in mind that each student must file their own FAFSA. So if you have more than one child entering college, maybe twins, or maybe you have a child who's already in college and a new child that may be starting next year, each one of those students need to fill out their own FAFSA. Okay. If the student is considered dependent, we're going to talk about that, then they must provide information about or parents. Okay. Independent students will only provide their information. If they're married, they must provide the information of their spouse as well. In a situation, if the parent is divorced or separated, normally you want the information of the student, and then usually the custodial parent, the parent in which the student lives. Now, we know there are some situations that a student may be living with both parents. If they're living with both parents equally, what Congress tells us is student information goes on the FAFSA, and whichever parent provided the most financial support to that child in the last 12 months, their information is included on that FAFSA. Now, I cannot tell you who provided the most financial support to that child. That's something that you're going to have to work out for. Schools can't help you with that. Now, if you are the parents of that child who haven't married, both of that information needs to go on to that form. If you are divorced and separated, but living in the same household still, both parents must include your information on that. If you are a same-sex parent, a step-parent, or an adopted parent, you are considered a parent, and your information must be included on the form. If you are a foster parent, or if a student is in legal guardianship, or if a student is living with grandma, aunt, uncle, another relative, neighbor, minister, boyfriend, girlfriend, none of them are considered a parent, and their information should not be included on that form. So this is what this is a screenshot of what the actual FAFSA looks like. So the student section is blue. It's clearly marked student. This is information about the student. Parent section is purple, and it's information about the parents. Don't mix this stuff up, okay? Because that'll create problems, because there's lots of checks and balances going on behind the scenes, verifying that the information you're providing is correct. The other nice thing I like about the online form is you get the helps and hints. Every single question on the online application just helps and hints pops up. Look at it if you have a question. It's really good. It'll tell you exactly what information goes in that box. Where is that information coming from? Is it coming from my tax return? If so, what tax return do I have? 1040, 1048, what line on that particular tax form is it gets included here? If it's information coming from your W-2 form, it'll tell you exactly on the W-2 form. And if you're, if it's other documents, asset information, then it'll explain to you what information you need to include it. So it's really, really helpful. So please look at that. Now I want to talk a little bit about dependency status because you, the parent, cannot make your children independent. And students cannot make themselves independent. Okay? And I know that in the state of Pennsylvania and nationally, sometimes when a child turns 18, we do consider them an adult. And there are certain programs and things that we consider an adult. We're only looking at your information, not for financial aid purposes. So the student is presented with 13 student status questions. And depending on how the student answers these questions will determine what the student's dependency status is. Most seniors answer no to all of these questions, therefore they are considered dependent, and they need to provide information for a parent or parents as well as loan information. Okay, what documents do you need? I like to go over this as well because this is where I see some mistakes happen. So we need the official Social Security number of both the student and the parent, or parents. Use the Social Security number, the name, and the date of birth that is on the official Social Security card. Please don't mix this up. Parents, don't mix your kids' Social Security numbers up with yours. Make sure when you're on that document, if you're helping them, you're answering, you know, you're in the right sections. Because Social Security Administration is behind the scenes, and it's verifying that that name, that Social Security number, and that date of birth all match. If they don't, that application could be rejected, or it'll be flagged, meaning that the student or parent will have to provide additional documentation to the school before they can actually process that form and before they can disperse any funds to the student. For my males between the age of 18 and 24, you are required to register for Selective Service to be considered for aids of the federal government and the state. Okay? So if you don't know if you are registered or not, another nice thing about the online form is a little box you can check because Selective Service is also reviewing that to determine whether you're registered if required or not. If you check that little box and you're required to register, no big deal, they'll automatically register. Now, I do encourage my males who are 17, because I have a lot of them that are in college and they're 17, they're not required to register. That's all. But once they turn 18, they must register for Selective Service and be considered for federal and state aid in the future. So they can check the box too. And Selective Service will automatically take care of that for you when you turn 18. You'll need your, as I said, your tax returns, W-2s. If you need asset information, you may need bank statements, other financial documents. One of the other requirements for the federal and the state government is you must be either a U.S. citizen or an eligible non-citizen. If you are an eligible non-citizen, then you will have either an alien registration number or a permanent residency card number, and you must provide that number on the FAFSA as well. Okay. The federal government gives you the opportunity to do this whole process electronically. Both the federal government and the state does require the student and a parent and dependent to sign the application. So, for the federal government, some of my parents, when you were in school, or maybe you already have a child in school, you may remember that you were able to set up what we call a personal identification number or a PIN. It's a four-digit number that either you created or the Department of Education assigned to you, and it acted as your legal electronic signature and the students. They did away with that whole process in 2015, and they came up with this FSA ID, which is much more secure. So each student would need to go out there and set up a user ID and password they created, you know, right on the FSA ID website, and this will act as their legal electronic signature, so they can do this whole process electronically. And the nice thing about that FSA ID, it's not only for the application, they can use that for a lot of other federal databases, you know, that they can tap into information that is pertains to. A parent would also need to set up their own user ID and password. Now, both parents can go out and get their own FSA ID if they like. You don't have to, as long as one has one. And for the parents, your FSA ID can be used for all your children's applications. So if anybody did that this year and had already set this up for a job, you will continue to use that same FSA ID set. But each student must have their own. This is something that my seniors can do now. I would tell you to do it prior to doing the FAFSA because it's a couple steps that you got to go through, and it's a lot easier to do it prior to doing it versus doing it at the same time you complete the FAFSA. But you can if you want. But this is something that you can do. Okay. The other change that took place this year that I want to mention as well, because I think it's important to the students as well, is the federal government on the online application gives the student the ability to list up a maximum of 10 schools. That's the max. Okay. The order in which those students list the school has no impact for the federal government process. They could care less. However, the federal government got wind that some schools were looking at the way the student listed them on the FAFSA, and in the past, those schools could see every other school that that student was considered. So we found out there were some schools saying, oh, I'm number one. That kid really wants to come here. Maybe I don't need to offer them as much aid. Or maybe I need to offer them more. You get that. Okay? Somebody says, oh, I'm number five. I guess they're not that interested. So we're not gonna, you know, they should not be using that information for that process. What the federal government did was they changed the process. So for students, you want to list every school that you're interested in, considering, may attend in the 17-18 academic year on the FAFSA. Okay, you can list them in any order you want. When the schools get the information, they are only going to see themselves. So every school is going to be listed as number one. And they're not going to know any other schools that you're looking at unless you talk. So you don't need to worry about the order in which you list those on the FAFSA. Please keep in mind also, students, that you do not have to be accepted to the school or applied to the school to list them on the FAFSA. So if you want to do this form early and you're still trying to figure out, but you have a number of schools that you want to consider, you can list them all. Okay, it's the only way to get the information. Now, as I said, maximum 10 schools. The PDF only allows school. That's another disadvantage of doing the PDF. If you have an 11th or 12th school, okay. The way you have to manage that is, I would tell you to take your top 10 schools that you're interested in, put them on your initial FAFSA, complete it, submit it, let it get processed. Okay, because when it gets processed, the student will get confirmation that their application is processed. All those schools are going to get that information. At that point, that student then can go back into that process FAFSA and make any changes. Have an 11th or 12th school or more, what you're going to do is once it's processed, you're going to go Please keep in mind, though, FAFSA only allows a maximum of 10. So that means one or two of the schools previously listed on there have to come on. You elect and decide who they are. You have to resubmit that application again. Parents, students, please keep in mind, because this is another error that I see happening all the time, is they go in and make updates or changes to the application that you submit. So the department doesn't get it, they don't process it, they don't send it out to the state or any other school. They don't know what you may have changed and how they may impact. So make sure you're submitting. So on that 11 to 12 school, once you submit it, all the other schools that remain on it will get another reprocessed FAFSA information. The new school or schools that you add will then get the results of that as well. The two schools that dropped off will not get any further information in the initial form, but after that, unless you put them back on, they will not get it. So that's how you have to handle that and manage that if you have more than 10 schools. Okay, so let's talk about the IRS data retrieval tool. Again, this was a process that was put in place that took many, 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 many years for the IRS to get on board with this. And again, it was there to just make this whole process simpler for students and families to complete. So for 2017-18, as I mentioned, you're going to be using your 2015 income tax information. Hopefully, or the majority of you should already have that done, so there's no reason for you to estimate. When you're in the application, and I'll show you where this is, you're going to be presented with some information to see if you can use this tool. And if you elect to use it, what happens is you go out to the IRS, it finds your tax return, it pulls all of the information that's required under FAFSA. You don't see the whole tax return. Only pulls in those information required from FAFSA, it presents that to you, and then asks you again to acknowledge, do you want to automatically update this? And you have to say yes, and boom, next, presto. When you go further into that application, you're going to see all those items are completed. You're also going to see that there's a tag on each one of those that says information came directly from the IRS. The reason that's important is there's a process out there called verification. Department of Education does select records for verification. There are several different types of verification. Okay, so if you are a student or a parent who is able to use this IRS data retrieval tool, your chances of being selected for verification are very slim. And even if you are, in most instances, you do not have to provide any additional data to any additional documentation to that school in order for them to process the student's application to the response. If you are selected for verification, all that means is the school must collect documentation, and it's very specific documentation, from the student and from the parent. You need to verify that all the information you entered on the FAFSA is correct before they will be able to disperse any funds to that student's account. Okay. So this is what it looks like. So in the financial section of the FAFSA, the online FAFSA, this option is presented both to the student and to the parents. Okay? Now, there are some of you that may not be eligible to use this process. Okay? Some examples of that are if you file a foreign tax return or a Puerto Rican tax return, you can't use it. If you filed your 2015 taxes and then went back in and amended them, so you actually file Form 10 through the X. An amended tax return, you can't use it. If you are married, but you file separate tax returns, you can't use it because the department can only pull in one set of numbers. And then there are certain situations now that if your marital status has changed, you may not be able to use this. So an example of that may be, because remember, we're using income information and tax information for 2015. You might have been married to somebody else, then, and their information being included. You may not be married to them anymore, therefore, you know, you shouldn't be looking at that information. So you will not be able to use this. And all of that information will be presented to you, so it's nothing you have to worry about in this. Now, if you can use it again, I encourage you to do so. There will be a little link there that says, it takes you right out to the IRS database. The only thing with that, with the IRS database, is you have to, it's going to ask me for, I think there's three or four questions that it asks you up front, and it's But on this form, you put it as ST, period, you won't find it. It's very sensitive. So just be aware of it. Okay? Okay. When you complete the form, you have to submit it. When you submit it, you will get this confirmation page. This confirmation page, please review it. There's a lot of really good information in there. One of the things that you are going to see, various options will be presented to you. It's a smart application, as I said. So for first-time applicants that need to complete the state grant form, here's a way in which they can do it at the same time they do the online form. So it knows that you are a Pennsylvania resident, and it will present a link for you to be able to complete your state grant form and link you right out to our online site to complete it. Okay? If you are a parent and you have more than one child entering college, and remember I said each student has to apply for financial aid on their own, and your information is the same. You'll see an option that allows you to download the parent information into that second child's application so you don't have to go through that process all over. It will tell you what your estimated family contribution is. So all the information that you provided in the FAFSA goes to a formula, and out of that, the result of that, you get a figure, an estimated family contribution. It's one of the components that we need to use to determine what students need. Okay? You will know that right away. It will tell you if your child is automatically eligible for the federal Pell Grant. It will tell you that what the student direct student loan eligibility is for that student. And then each school that they listed on FAFSA, there are actually links to it. They will give additional information about each one of those institutions. If that student is interested, they can link into that and they can write to that information. So there's a lot of really good information on that confirmation page. Please review it, look at it, because I think it will help you. Okay, now, with the online state grant form, you have that online link. If for some reason the student missed that, okay, the Department of Education only allows us to show that the first time. So if the student completed the FAFSA, submitted it, and got out of the system, and said, oh, I didn't do my state grant form, they go back into it at any time, they'll never see that link again. Don't worry about it, okay? As I said, we get a copy of every student's FAFSA application. So we have, if there's a valid email address in that application, we will email a link out to the student where they can complete the state grant form on our website. If we don't have a valid email address, then what we do is we send, I think it's a postcard now, with information and a link and instructions on where that student can go on the via website, via.org, to complete that state grant form. Please keep in mind also, this application is necessary in order to complete the student state grant application. But it's not tied to our deadlines. So if that student completed the FAFSA May 1st, if that was the deadline, or August 1st, but did not complete this till September, October, November, December, once they complete it, they'll complete the student's application, and we will then determine what their state grant eligibility is. But up until that time, it stays incomplete. Okay? So it doesn't impact the deadline. So we'll take the information, whatever we get. Now, there is a time frame. I think it's 17, 18 years that you have to have that information in terms of people first, 2018, to be able to get state grant aid for that year. The other thing is, unfortunately, we, the state, do not have an electronic signature. You must sign the form. You can't use your FSA ID, unfortunately. So, no, it doesn't matter if the student does it online or does the paper version or goes out to our website. Every student has to print out the signature page. They need to sign it. If dependent, at least one parent needs to sign it. And then they just mail that information via, and that completes the whole process. Okay? All right. So that's a lot of information. That's all the forms and all you need to do. Okay? What happens once you submit it? So this is a sign. So you complete the FAFSA, you submit it. The information is sent to the Federal Government Central Processing Servicer, who actually puts that information through the federal form. The results of that is the estimated family contribution. It's a number. It will be different for all of them. Okay. The information is sent to the student, so the student gets an electronic copy or a paper copy, again, depending on the email address. And it's a summary of everything that's listed in the FAFSA. Information is sent to the state. Information is sent to all the schools listed on that form. The schools and the state put it through their process, and then they send out bit about how we determine EFC. FAST is very income driven. Does look at a lot of asset information, and unfortunately, if you are a family with a lot of debt, FAST is not your friend. You can't tell your story. It's a very black and white form. So if there are special conditions happening with the family, we're going to talk about that. But you can't add that. You can't email it to the department. They won't look at anything. So for the parent, these are the major components that FAST looks at. Parent income and assets, student income and assets, size of the family, the number in college, and age of the older parent. For the parents, there's income and asset protection allowance. So we do allow for any taxes, whether it's local, state, regional, or federal. There is allowances for a working parent or parents. There is a standard living allowance that is all calculated in the formula. When we look at asset information, we do not include the value of your primary residence. So if you have a mortgage on that, or you loan it outright, it doesn't matter. It does not get included on the FAST. Your retirement funds, the value of your retirement fund, do not include that in the FAST. If you're asked for asset information, do not include the value of your retirement fund. It doesn't get considered. No insurance policies get considered. If anyone has a farm or lives on a farm, you do not have to provide any information about the assets of that farm. And if you have a family-owned business and you control more than 50% of that and have 100 or less full-time employees or equivalent, you do not have to provide any information about that business long or fast. Now, CSS profile, let me ask you about it. What kind of car you drive, how many animals you have. You can ask anything you want. That's a lot. Okay? So please do not include that. For the student, the other thing is, I just wanted to mention with regards to the parents, if you are required to provide assets, and you're all going to know that, another reason why I like the online form, because when you get to this section, based on the information that you provided on the FAST, each of you are going to be presented with a question that's going to say, does the parent's assets exceed this amount? So that's the amount that is protected. If your assets do not exceed that amount, you are not required to put any additional asset information in the form. You can, if the schools want it, but FAST won't look at it. They won't even consider it, and you're not required to report it. Now, if your assets exceed that amount, and you're going to say yes, and you will be presented three additional asset questions. And as I said earlier, you must provide the net value of your assets as of the date of filing the FAST. Okay. So now for the students, there is income protection allowance and no asset protection allowance. So again, we allow for any taxes that you're responsible for. Currently, right now, the student can earn income up to $6,420. And none of that is local. Anything over that amount, it's actually a little bit higher because of the allowances that we're taking in for taxes. But anything over and above that is assessed at 50% in the formula that determines the student contribution. Asset information, students must report any assets they own that are in their name. Okay? They are assessed at 20%. Now, the only one that's different here is if you are participating in a 529 plan, and if that is in the student's name, it's always considered an asset of the parent. So that never gets included as an asset for the student. And again, you may be reporting that if you're required to report asset information. You may not, depending on what your asset protection allowance is. So just keep that in mind. Okay. So I said two components for the EFC. The second one is the cost of attendance. Each school must develop a cost of attendance, submit that to the federal government and the state. These are all the components that each school uses. Tuition fees, room and board, if the student's living on campus, even if the student is not living on campus, living off campus or commuting from home, there's still a living expense. There are books, supplies, transportation, miscellaneous living expenses, there's your child care expenses, that all can be included in the school's cost of attendance. This is what I refer to as the sticker price at the school. Hopefully, the majority of you will not pay that sticker price. So So here's the way the formula works. So we take the cost of attendance, the sticker price at that school. Now keep in mind, this is going to vary. This all depends on the school that the student's looking at. Community college is a lot less than a state school or state related school. Okay? So the cost of attendance at schools may vary. That EFC that gets calculated, remember, it always stays the same, as I said earlier. So it doesn't matter what type of school that student is going to, that ESD stays the same. We subtract that ESC from the cost, what is left is the need. This example, we have a need of $26,000. This is what the financial aid office of the schools are looking at. And they're going to award that student need-based aid up to maybe 100% of that need, or it could be less. It's a good question to ask the schools, or go on their website to see how much of a student's need do they meet with financial aid. Okay. So, as I said, some need 100%, some need less. The student will get an award letter from the school. It's the official notification to the student. It'll have all the rights, conditions, and terms that the student needs to meet to accept that aid or reject that aid. It'll have all the aid listed that the student would be eligible for at that institution. Now, some schools do require what I call active confirmation. Some schools will require the student to inform them or send them a award letter back accepting or rejecting any aid they want. Other schools assume that if the student doesn't want something the school offered, the student will let the school know. So they don't require the student to send anything back, they assume they're accepting all of it. So again, you want to just make sure you're aware of the policies and procedures of the various schools that your children are looking at, so that you're following through. Please make sure you look at those award letters, understand it. This is where I do see some problems that students have. So if you're getting a merit scholarship, know the terms and conditions, know how you continue to get that, what you need to do. If you're getting need-based grants and scholarships, make sure you know it's a grant or a scholarship for free money. What do you need to do to continue to get that or receive that aid? If you're getting federal work study, you know, what do you need to do in order to get a job on campus? How does that process work? If there's a loan, who does the loan belong to? Is it the student? Is it the parent? What's the interest rate? What are the terms and conditions of that as well? Because some schools have their own institutional loans as well. So just make sure you review it, read it, understand it if you don't contact the school. I know when, the busy time gets, it's hard to get through them. So I can help you with this as well. Please feel free to reach out to me, and I'll do my best. Now, this is another thing I wanted to talk about, special circumstances. So as I said, fast is black and white. Can't tell your story. These are the ones that I normally see. So recent divorce or separation, somebody loses a job, maybe there is sickness in the family, or there's high medical or dental expenses that are not covered by insurance, there's death or disability, somebody's income is reduced, and there are many, many more, okay? So these circumstances absolutely do impact your financial situation. The only way the school will be able to help you and to assist you with this is to talk to them. That's the only way they're going to get this information. And I really encourage you to do that. It can happen at any time, even when the child is in school. If something changes within your family, talk to the school. The worst thing they can say to you is no. Okay? But the only way they're going to know about it, the only way they're going to be able to determine how that may impact aid that that student may already be receiving, or other aid that they may now be eligible for, or other types of aid, is if you let them know. So that's how you have to handle that. Very quickly, we've only been here a good amount of time, so I just want to throw some numbers at you. So for the Federal Pell Grant Program, which is their flagship program, currently the maximum amount for 16-17 current year is $5,815. Full-time student. And it doesn't matter what the cost of attendance is at the school. This is a maximum amount that a student can get from the federal government, and it's usually awarded to low-income students. Campus-based aid, they are also federal programs, and that's institutional money and federal money. Now, when you get those award letters from the schools, you're going to see that there are differences. Some may offer you a federal supplemental educational opportunity grant, or work study, or both. Some may not. And the reason may be is maybe they don't participate, or maybe the student wasn't eligible, or perhaps they ran out of money. Okay, but you can always ask. The Federal Supplemental Educational Opportunity Grant is another grant from the federal government. Congress mandates that the school cannot award any more than $4,000 in an academic year to a student. And remember, this is a year. So all this money gets split. If it's a semester school, if they operate on a quarter basis, everything gets split into three. Okay? So these are yearly amounts. In most instances, a student will probably not get $4,000 in SEOG because it's a very limited fund in most schools. Federal work study, there's no limit. School can award to a student as much money as they have in their fund. However, a student can never receive more financial aid than the cost of attendance. This website here, studentaid.gov, will give you a list of all those other federal programs that I talked about. They're very specific. Also mentioned in the guide, so you can review that just to see if there's anything else there that perhaps your child might be eligible for. State grant money, our maximum currently is $4,378 for a student who is attending full-time in a Pennsylvania school. Okay? If they're going half-time, which is to credit, they can get half of it. Now, please keep in mind, students go to any type of school in Pennsylvania, not just a state school. Okay, they can use the state grant. Any school, as long as that school is participating. Okay? I get that question a lot from families, can I only use this at a state school? Now, if the student is attending a school outside of Pennsylvania, then there are six states listed up there that we have reciprocal agreements with, and that student could take potentially about $600, a maximum $600 of the Pennsylvania state grant money to use at that school. Our minimum award is $500. So if the student is ineligible for at least $500, they're not going to be awarded anything. If they're going to school in any other state, they can't use their PA state grant at that school. Okay. And then again, we have some other programs that are out there as well, and they're listed on the website and on the in the booklet. As I said, the students are all eligible for a loan. It's in their name. They're responsible for paying it back. The student would never, the federal government would never come after the parent to pay this loan back if the student was to become delinquent or default. It's their loan. Again, there is a maximum amount that they can borrow each year based on the grade level, and there's an aggregate amount that they can borrow for the life of the program. The interest rate of these loans is determined by Congress each year. So July 1, they reset the interest rates. Okay? They're capped at 8.25%. They would never be any higher than that. Currently, you can see it's 3.76%. For the current year, and there are some slight fees that come off of that. Student does not have to make any payments while they're in school. They can make interest payments if they like, or not make any payments at all. Every student is given a 6-month grace period after they graduate before they go into repayment. And then the student also has a very numbers of repayment options that they can choose from on that program as well. Now, the other thing about the student loan is there are two types, subsidized and unsubsidized, and I just want you to be familiar with that. So, the school must determine the student's eligibility for subsidized loan first, and all that means is if the student is eligible for a subsidized loan, the federal government will pay the interest on that loan while the student is in school at least half time, during any grace period, and during any deferment period that the student may be eligible for when they go into repayment. If it's unsubsidized, then the student is responsible for not only the principal amount that they borrow, but also all of the interest that's accruing on that loan as well. Okay. This is a quick chart. So for a first-year student, just so you have numbers, $5,500 per dependent student. That's the max they can borrow. No matter if they're going to a community college, where the tuition fees are low, or they're going to maybe a private school, where it may be $60,000, they can borrow only $5,500, and no more. $3,500 of that can be subsidized. Now, you'll also notice that independent students can borrow at a little bit higher amounts than a dependent student. There is a situation that I want to make mention that if you, the parent, elect to go out to participate in that federal parent loan, unfortunately, the government puts you through a credit check. Students don't get it, but you do. You need to pass that. If you don't pass that, and you elect not to do anything with that, then that dependent student would be eligible to borrow an additional $4,000 the first year of unsubsidized money. So they could borrow at the same rate as an independent student. Okay? Nothing the student needs to do. The schools can determine that automatically, and they get that information. So for the parent loan, again, there is a slight credit check. Congress determines each year what the components of that are. Congress says parent can have an adverse credit issue. If you are denied, you can appeal it, or you can apply with a cosigner, or you can elect not to do anything at all. You are not tied to the same loan limits as a student, so you can borrow up to the cost of attendance minus any other aid the students get. The interest rate is determined by Congress each year, as you can see. Currently, it's 6.31%, and there's some pretty hefty fees that come off the top of it as well. You do not have to make any repayments on that loan while the student is in school, at least half time. You can elect to make payments after that student graduates, if you like, or you can make interest payments only, or you can start paying back the loan plus interest 60 days after the loan is fully disbursed. So it'll be up to you. Other loans that are out there, again, I would tell you, look at all the aid from the federal government, the state, the institutions first, but there are what we call private alternative loans out there. They are not federally regulated. The interest rates, the rules and regulations, the amount that the student can borrow, the repayment options that are available to them, and any other benefits are determined by that bank, that credit union, the financial institution that is offering this student. You can go out, talk to the schools about this. You can go out on the internet and Google them and look at it. My only caution to you is please make sure you read the terms and conditions and the fine print and you know what you're getting into. Yes, you can get some of these loans currently now at very low interest rate, 3-4%. Or a student could borrow an alternative private loan, but I guarantee you, you will not get it without a cosign. Now, you'll find that some of these private loans, one of the benefits some of them offer, not all of them, so I say read the fine print, is they have a cosigner release. And they say when that student goes into repayment, and they're not required to make any payments while they're in school, just like the federal one, but when they go into repayment, if that student makes so many payments on time, it'll be 12 months, 24 months, 48 months, whatever that bank or financial institution decides, they will release the cosign. So at that point, if that student was to become delinquent or default on that loan, they would never come after you, the cosign. It's now fully the student's loan. Otherwise, they would, if they default or become delinquent. So I'm just gonna go through a couple of things. Scholarships, outside private scholarships, I talked about a little bit earlier. That's at fourth source. Does require the student to do some research. Students, please do it every year. You reapply for financial aid every year. Please do this with new outside scholarships coming on board all the time. We have a scholarship tip sheet that gives you some sites, two sites that you can go out to. You can go over the internet, Google it, all of that. Just make sure that you're using the free site. So if you want a site that says for a fee, we'll guarantee the scholarship, or if we're charging you for that information, stay off of those sites. Only you'll be able to provide the information that you did that for free, or it's a scheme. So please look at those outside scholarships, research that each year. I do want to mention this, though, because as I said earlier, all depends on the school's policy, how they handle this. Most schools, when a student brings an outside scholarship in, it's in addition to the aid that the school is already offering to that student, but there are some schools that may reduce their aid by a certain percentage or whatever. If a student's bringing outside money, so you have to make sure you're aware of what their policy is. Okay. And then I just have a couple of things that you could be doing now. So as I said earlier, students, parents, you can go get that FSA ID, go out to the school's website, so make yourself familiar with the information there, research outside scholarship, net price calculator. We didn't talk much about that. It's been out there for a while, but all that is remember the sticker price that I told you about the school? Well, each school has a net price calculator on their website. There are other places as well. The federal government offers them also. And basically what that tells you is, here, if you're looking at this school, here's what our sticker price is. Here's the average grants and scholarships that students receive at our school. Subtract that from the sticker price, and that's the net price. And this is what students who attend that school are normally charged for. Okay? Just be cautious that net price calculators are not all equal. So there are some very sophisticated calculators out there. How you know the difference is if you go on the school's website and they ask you for a lot of information, if your information is accurate and correct, the information that comes out of that net price calculator
If you're asking for very general information, it's just use the information as an estimate.
Right. This is a tool that we have that I wanted to mention. There are many on the FEMA website, all free for you. But I wanted to mention this only because you can see the net price of every institution, whether it's a business, trade, or technical, private school, whatever, on this site. The other thing that we do is we try to give the student even more information. So we ask the student, okay, what kind of career are you going to have? What kind of job are you going to have? And where are you going to be doing that job? So you're going to be in California, you're going to be in New York, you're going to be in Philadelphia. So I'm going to be a civil engineer, and I'm going to work in Philadelphia, and I'm going to live downtown Philadelphia. So what we do is, based on that information, we present to that student what their potential first-year salary would look like. We then also ask the student a bunch of other questions. So, what kind of aid are you getting from that school, if you're aware of it? Are you bringing any contribution in from your family, an outside scholarship? And then if there's any balance left over, we assume that the student is going to borrow that. So we will also present to the student that if you borrow this much money, here's what your monthly payment's going to look like on a standard 10-year repayment plan. So as I said, the federal government has lots of repayment plans. Student can select whatever they want. If they don't, it defaults to the standard 10-year repayment plan. That means the student pays X amount of dollars each month, the same amount each month, up until 10 years when they have their own repayment. Federal government also offers some loan forgiveness programs out there as well. So this site allows you to view all that information. You can compare up to 4 schools at a time if you'd like. There's a mobile app that's available as well that you can do on your smartphone. So it's a nice tool. Especially for my junior families, this is a good way in which you can start putting the pieces together. So this just kind of walks you through the process. It's very easy. And the very, very last thing I promise that I'm going to say this evening is I just want to talk about the fifth year, because I think this catches a lot of students and families off guard. So when a student enters a 4-year institution, that program is set up for that student to complete that degree within 4 years. Fortunately, we have a number of our students that are going to 4-year programs and they're taking 5 and 6 years to graduate. There's a lot of reasons why they're doing that, and a lot of good reasons, okay? Some of them I have up there. So maybe the student changes their major, maybe they're dual major, maybe they're taking advantage of a study abroad, an internship, adding, dropping classes. Okay, I usually encourage students that if you're getting financial aid and you're doing any of this, talk to financial aid. They will tell you how it will impact you. But there are limits to the amount of aid that a student can get. So for state grant purposes, we will only award a student unless they're in a bona fide 5-year program, and there aren't many in Pennsylvania. We will award them up to 4 years of full-time eligibility. After that, you're done. Same thing with the federal government. 12 semesters or 600%. Eligibility. If the student took out that federal loan, borrowed the max that they could borrow each year, in that fifth year, they would only have $4,000 left, which the previous year they had 10-5. You're going to get the bill in June, July, sometime around then. You know that the student has always gotten state aid, federal aid. You're looking for it, it's all missing here, thinking what happened. And I don't want you to be blindsided. So just be aware of this. That if students are making changes, adding dual major, it could impact the cost, the overall cost of that school, and it may impact the financial aid as well. So I will conclude my remarks with that. I will give you my email address again if you didn't take it, and I thank you for coming out tonight and participating in this. I hope the information is helpful. I hope it answers some of your questions. However, if you have questions either tonight or after this evening, please feel free to reach out to me. I will provide my presentation to the school, and if any of you would like to have this person yourself, just email me. I'd be more than happy to send it to you, because I know it's a lot of stuff to digest. So, are there any general questions that I can address for anyone? Any clarifications or anything that I can do? Yes, ma'am. Excellent question. Okay. So the question was that when you start the FAFSA application and or the CSS profile, do you have to complete it all in one sitting? And the answer is no. So FAFSA will actually take you about 20 minutes. It's a CSS profile, it'll take you longer because it asks for a lot more stuff. But you can actually, for the FAFSA, you can start the application and you can save it, and it will save for 45 days. If you go back into that application before the 45 days elapse, then you get another 45 days, okay? But if you don't, then all the information disappears at the start of it. I don't know what the timeline is in the CSS profile. I'm trying to think. It will save, you can save that application, you can start and save it. Their timeline may be a little bit longer, but the information is going to mention. That's managed by College Board. You can actually just Google CSS profile or go on College Board's website, and it'll give you all the information about the CSS profile. It'll also tell you every school that uses it, collects it, so it's not a secret, it's all out there. Okay. Any other questions that, yes, sir? Okay, so the question was, the EFC is used to determine the student's need, and is that what is expected of the family? So, based on the federal government's formula, and they collect all this information from you, and it's not a perfect formula either, but they treat everybody the same, and as I said, it's very income-driven more than anything. That EFC, based on the information provided, the federal government feels that the student and the family could contribute that amount to that child's education. Now, will you pay that? Do you need to pay that? No. Okay? But it is a number that the schools will use. It's the official number that the schools will use to determine that student's need at that school. So remember the calculation, cost of attendance minus the EFC equals the need. So the cost could change and the need could change. The EFC never stays the same. But yes, unless you have some kind of special circumstance going on or something else going on within your family, you know, and if you think you do or you're not sure you do, just talk to the school. You know, we'll let you know. I know that many times when students and families came to me, there was a lot of stuff that came out in that conversation that I would have never known about unless they came to see me. And some of it did impact that student's eligibility. Now, please keep in mind, you may have a special circumstance or condition. The school may agree with that and say, yes, we absolutely do. And they have the ability to override the federal formula. You know, but sometimes, you know, even doing that, it does not change the student's aid because students kind of fall into a category, so you can be higher or lower on them, so you can still wind up in the same category, even though they were taking that special circumstance into consideration. But I would most definitely discuss that with the school. For the state, unfortunately, we do not give the schools the ability to do an override of our formula because of the way our program is legislated by our legislators. So, you know, if a student has circumstances or special concerns happening within their family, we always tell the school to direct them to us. The student or parent can call us, you know, and then they can just write a letter of appeal, and we will look at that and follow up with the student directly on that as far as state grant eligibility. Well, the other thing I wanted to mention about state grant eligibility that I forgot was, if you are in a Pennsylvania 529 plan, we do not consider that a resource when determining the student's eligibility for the state grant. But it's only a Pennsylvania 529 plan, so whether you're in a guarantee plan or an investment plan. And that's one of the questions that we ask in the state grant form because we can't get that information from the FAFSA. So if you were including 529 information on the FAFSA as an asset, if it's a Pennsylvania 529 plan, you definitely want to let us know because we do not look at that as a resource to determine the student state grant eligibility. So I forgot to mention. Okay. Any other questions before? Yes, sir. So the question was that any of the tuition that you, the student, the family are paying, is any of that tax deductible? And actually, yes, there are some tax credits out there. There's a couple of them, but to be honest with you, I don't have all that in my head. There is the lifetime learning credit, and then there's another deduction. They're a little bit different. You can't take both at the same time, you know, one or the other. I'm trying to, because they renamed it all. You know, and I know it's, I think it's up to like $2,500 for each student that you would be able to take off of your taxes. And that's all built into the tax forms. Okay. And there's information on that. And you can actually go out there and even Google that, or probably on our site as well. Just look for educational tax credits. But yes, there are some. Well, any other questions that I can help clarify or answer, or I'll let you all go. So again, I appreciate it. Thank you. I hope this information is helpful. I hope it's not overwhelming. Don't be overwhelmed.